Now I move to agenda item 8, please, which is pages 67 to 74, Mural Packs, which is Mill House, 79 Mill House Lane, Morton. Could we have a presentation, please?
Thank you, Chair. This application is for the Mill House Pub on Mill House Lane. The proposal is to demolish the existing pub building, which has been vacant for a number of years now, and to erect 28 on two-bedroom flats. It's a residential area. It's an area where we would normally look to support appropriate residential development. There is a planning history on the site that gives a consent for 38 units that were approved by the and there's still an extant consent. This application is by Liverpool Housing Trust. It's for 28 affordable units. It takes the form of five blocks that are in a cul-de-sac. So the development, as I said, takes the form of a cul-de-sac which fits in with sort of the surrounding residential area. The buildings are two-storey, although they have a bedroom in the upper floor. So you have a single bed flat on the ground floor and then a two-bedroom flat on the first floor and a bedroom in the roof space. There's 30 parking spaces proposed with the development, which is two more than we normally look for a scheme of this size. There's garden space around the proposals, and it reads kind of as a housing development because it's two-storey, because it's split into blocks. The design's fairly simple, traditional like houses, and it's of a scale that's comparable to houses. In terms of interface distances to existing properties, the interface distances are achieved with this proposal in terms of impact on surrounding properties and gardens. There is bin storage as shown on the plans, but also as a condition of the application, so we can approve details of it. Given that it's in a residential area and it is a scheme that provides affordable housing, it is one that's recommended for approval.
Okay, thank you. Is there a ward councillor who would like to speak on this?
Councillor Chris Blakeman from Worcester Southern Massey. And members would be delighted to know that I'm normally sat here objecting vociferously to applications. I'm here tonight to support this application. Accuracy, on page 68, it talks about the 38 residential farms and allowed on appeal. It's actually 34. The original application was 38, with very few parking spaces. The applicant submitted a revised application for 34, and it was a 34 that was allowed on appeal. I think that's important, because a planning inspector might not have approved it with 38. Who knows? Something will never know. But other than that, yes, there have been a few people who have concerns, but overall, the majority of people want to see this site redeveloped, and I'm hoping that tonight members will support the officer's recommendation. Well, I normally say members will oppose the officer's recommendation, but you know, hope you say the anything better. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you, Chris. I just wanted to ask the officers to clarify, because we've already had approval on this site, as you've heard, of 34 units. If it was approved this evening, what would the situation be? If we approve this application, does one take precedence over the other?
Through you, Chair, no. The application is a completely different layout. They could only implement one or the other, so they would have to choose which one to
implement.
If I may, Chair, just not much to take part in the debate, but I understand the previous
Chris,
the previous applicant is now the developer.
Okay, can I
very briefly, this is a far better proposal than the one that was approved on appeal, so I'm happy to support it.
Ian?
Thanks, Claire. This site is an absolute eyesore. It's been subject to quite a bit of media comment over the years, which is the way it's deteriorated and creates a blight on that particular community. But this one point about the planning officer, I'm not too clear on this one, so forgive me if it's an obvious question or I can know better. But on page 69, where it says the application has been submitted by Liverpool Housing Trust, etc., to develop this site for 100% affordable housing. Does this mean the Liverpool Housing Trust is developing this site for apartments for rent, or are they looking to sell these on the open market? Can we just have some clarity on that, please?
I don't have clarity on that, I'm afraid. It wouldn't normally inform the decision making of the application. What will happen is a condition relating to affordable housing, which requires details of the selection process and how the units will then be allocated as affordable. That's how we're assessing this problem. In terms of the application,
sorry, I was just seeking clarity whether it's affordable in terms of people wanting to buy it or affordable to rent it. That's not clear.
To continue that point, as a development of 28 houses in an area, would this be racist need or not? In any event, the minimum requirement we would want in a return of 10 would be 6, so somewhere between 3 and 6 would be the minimum affordable requirement. So presumably, we would look at that. We would have a view as to whether that was affordable in terms of rent or affordable in terms of purchase. So, what's
the kind of implication?
Okay.
I would emphasise this isn't a deal breaker, but it's a point of general necessity to two of us that as a site. If the developer had come along and said, I'm going to sell these, we would have said, it's 28, we require you to have 6 foot. Now, what would we have meant by that? Would we have meant, okay, you're planning to sell them, we want you to sell 6 on an affordable price? Or, okay, you're planning to sell them, we want you to rent 6 on an affordable price?
I've just been advised that
10
doesn't actually come into into the planning application, and so it would be up to the developer to decide whether he was going to actually sell these properties or whether he was going to rent these properties or whether it be a mix. So it would be their decision to make. Okay, if nobody else has got anything to say, then this is listed as for approval subject to the conditions listed, as well as the extra condition on the leg list. Do I have a mover for that? Okay, I'll take David's second, Ian. Okay, all those in favour of approval? That's unanimous, that's carried, thank you. A site visit. So if we move to agenda item 10, which is pages 83-88 to your pack, which is Barnsendale Centre. Can we have a presentation, please?
Thank you, Chair. This application is the Barnsendale Centre in Barnston, which is an outdoor activity centre. Because it's doing so well, it's proven so popular, they're going to increase demand for the facilities and have had to take on more staff. So the usual staff facilities that they have are not adequate, and they're proposing that they would want a building in the car park area, or near the car park area.
I'm sorry, sir, is it
in
the car park?
Agenda item 9.
We'd actually said that we were going to have a site visit on that, sir. I'm sorry if you arrived late and missed that.
I just made sure.
Okay, okay, I do apologise.
So
we won't be discussing that this evening. We will have a site visit, which I've forgotten, which is on the 12th of December, and then it will come to the next planning committee, which will be on the 14th of December. Okay, thank you. So I'm sorry that you didn't get that information. Sorry to interrupt you.
Thank you, Chair. So the proposing a single storey modular building in the front of the development. It's provide canteen facilities for the being reasonable to stand. It sits within a group of existing buildings and it replaces a shed which is slightly smaller and is used for storage. We're considering it's an appropriate development in the green belt because of the nature of the use, and it isn't strictly speaking an outdoor use. So we've requested very special circumstances. The very special circumstances that have been put forward by the applicant on the need for the facilities for staff to satisfy health and safety regulations. The fact that there's an existing shed there, which is slightly smaller, but in the same position. In addition to that, it's about 20 metres away from the front of the site. You can't see it. It's very well screened. It will have very little impact on the character of the green belt. And it's recommended for approval.
Is there a board council to speak on this? No, okay. Can I open it up to committee, please? Gina?
Just a point of clarity. Did you say the existing shed was smaller than the proposed building?
Yes.
Do we have the measurements of this proposed building? And this is where staff, that's their staff room?
No. The existing shed is just used for storage. It just happens that there's a shed in that position. And the can move the storage to within the existing buildings, but we need a bigger facility to provide canteen for staff effectively.
Did you think the shed was a
currently yes.
Okay. No, the shed was actually used for storage.
Right.
Because the business has expanded, we're now looking to have a porter cabin which will act as basically a staff room. Okay, if nobody wants to come in on this, the officer's recommendation is to approve subject to the conditions listed. Do I have a mover? Thank you, David. Do I have a seconder? Thank you, Eddie. All those in favour of approval? That's unanimous. Thank you very much. Agenda item 11 is site visit. So we'll move on to agenda item 12, David and any orders move on. It's pages 95 to 100 in your pack, which is 15 Harrington Road. We have a presentation, please.
Thank you, Chair, through your Chair. Councillor Jerry Ellis has requested that this application be taken out of delegation due to the size and the bulk of the development and its close proximity to existing dwellings. We received one objection on the grounds that the proposed house and garage are closer to the side boundaries than the existing properties. This application is for construction of a two-storey detached house between numbers 14 and 15 Heron Road. The site is within a designated primary residential area. There's an extant outline planning permission on the site, with the indicative plan indicating a similar footprint to this current proposal. The principle of a new house on this site has therefore been established. The application site is of a similar width and depth to the surrounding properties within a row of semi-detached houses. The proposed house will retain a distance of approximately 1 metre outside to ensure even spacing. The proposed one will have the same ridge height as the two flanking properties, and the design emulates the details of the existing houses. The proposal also includes a detached garage to the rear of the plot. This lies alongside a number of similar structures. There's been an objection to the proposal, which relates to the fact that the proposed house will be closer to the side boundaries than the existing property. As I mentioned before, there's a metre gap proposed either side of this new dwelling. The existing properties have approximately a 1.7 metre gap either side. Nevertheless, a metre is considered to be acceptable in this instance and will not result in a detrimental impact on the residential metres of adjacent occupiers or the character and appearance of the area. It's therefore recommended for approval subject to the attached conditions.
Thank you. Is there a board council wants to speak on this? Can I open it up to committee, please? Was Jerry asking the
was
yet?
Well, it might be on the low or
something. So can we just check on that, please?
Yeah.
Thank you. Then can I open it up to committee, please? Any comments from committee?
Through you, Chair. I think it's kind of what was the plan here, which we haven't got yet. To me, it looks very nice.
Okay, if there's no other comments, Denise, you want to move approval?
Yes, Chair, I'll move it.
Kathy, you're second. Okay, all those in favour, subject to the conditions listed? That's unanimous, apart from the two who left. Thank you very much. Okay, so if we move now on to agenda item 13. They won't realise it's been done too.
We'll need to come back to you on that point, obviously, when when we finished the consultation, we published the register on the 22nd of December. There is a requirement that on an annual basis, the planning committee reviews the register, and I mentioned that, so we'll need to bring back an annual report to you. And as we're publishing in December, we'll probably be back in 12 months' time in December 2018 around that. You can see in the delegated report here, there are a series of recommendations that have been approved as a cabinet member, and that just explains how the process would work and who has the organisations to put the register in place and so on. I was asked as part of the presentation of this report if I could just confirm a number of other figures to the planning committee regarding the situation with planning applications and a number of other things. So I was asked if I could confirm how many units there were with planning permission that had not yet started in the world. And there are 1,879 units with planning permission that have not started on site. I was also asked to just give a figure for the number of dwellings that could go on the sites that we are consulting on as part of the Branfield Register. And that number is 3,648. I was also asked a question about the pledge in the Will 2020 plan, and this is the pledge to build 3,500 units over the next 5 years, and I was asked to just report on progress on that. To date, since April 2015, 1,299 units have been built. I was also then just asked to confirm what the figures were for those residential dwellings currently under construction in 2016 and also for 2017, the present year. So in 2016, under construction, there were 475 units. And in 2017, under construction, there were 1,315 units. So that's a significant acceleration in the house building programme in 2017. The reasons for that are that we, as officers at the moment, are doing intensive pieces of work on sites that currently have planning permission to try and bring those forward. We are also doing a series of viability assessments on quite difficult sites to help support development. We are looking at all of the our current employment sites where there's no more demand and trying to bring those forward. So the Burton site in Morton would be an example of that. We're also tackling some quite challenging sites. If you have seen the recent development at Upton Pines, just behind the Sainsbury's there, that is an example of a site that was heavily contaminated, it's been vacant for 30 years. We've now got sustainable housing development. And we're also looking at the density of those developments as well on sites to try and maximise the contribution that those sites make. The other area where we're intensively working at the moment around seeking to create housing units is in Wirral Waters. We're currently actively working on three schemes there that, if they come to pass, will create 1,000 units of accommodation. And those schemes are, as I say, at various stages of progression at the moment. But hopefully, they will come on stream and help to contribute towards the figures to achieve the 3,500 pledge. So, answer any questions there are.
Okay, thank you. Well, thank you for some quite informative information. So, can I break it through a second?
Mine is slightly off the planning side of it. You know, you talk about all the properties that you're going to build. What about all, how many properties have we got that are actually empty? That haven't been filled yet? And all those that are derelict that could be done up and reused? Do we have a register for those? Because I know we've got a lot in our area that are just boarded up and haven't been used for ages. And, you know, there's a scheme that's gone down on in Liverpool where people have been buying them for £1 and doing them all and bringing communities back in. So why aren't we doing something about that in the world?
Okay. I don't have the actual figures in front of me at the moment, so I can get those for you. Approximately, we have about 6,000 vacant properties in Willow at the present time. We have a very active empty property team, and I think at the last count we brought about 2,000 of those units back into use. And we're working proactively at the present time with owners of properties, with developers, and trying to find solutions, because clearly those vacant properties are a resource that we should be able to use for the benefit of Willow residents. It's also just important to say that in terms of empty properties, there will always be a certain number of empty properties because you have the churn due to the normal housing market and, you know, where you've got clerical residential place and things like that, the people moving around, so you'll never get to a zero number. But it is something that we did recognise a number of years ago now. So we have a specific team that works for me that actually focuses on this problem. We've done some great work in actually getting some really difficult and challenging properties back into use. The other area in terms of those types of properties as well is where sometimes you have under-occupancy. You know, so you may only have one person living in a very big house. And we tend to try and work with some of those people once. You know, they have a choice to live in that accommodation if they so wish. It really helps and support to move to appropriate accommodation, and then we can make that available for family accommodation. We work with people along those lines as well. So I hope that answers the question.
Okay, so Trina?
Yeah. I'm David, and it's great to hear that, you know, we're actually doing lots of work from 2016 to 2017 to meet our target and our pledge. You mentioned 1,879 properties that have planning permission that have not yet been built. Can you tell me some of the reasons why this happens and what we're doing in order to get them moving along?
Yes, there are a number of reasons why planning permissions are given and they're not implemented. Some of those could be to do with just the economic reasons, building properties. Others could be because a landowner may wish to get planning permission because it raises the value of their site and then they can sell it or do other things with it. Sometimes it's an issue of finance. Other times it's to do with landowner ownership issues. You know, there's a whole range of reasons why planning permissions may not be implemented. What we're doing at the moment from the council's point of view is we are going around each of those sites that have got approved planning permissions. We do this on a regular basis. We talk to the owners. We try and support them, enable them, persuade them to bring forward those planning permissions and develop the housing on there. If they cannot do it themselves, then we can introduce them to developers, ourselves, and other partners that can actually do that. If they have viability issues, we've got some people in with us at the moment helping to look at that and to close those viability gaps. And we can also help to support, you know, where there may be access to finance issues, you know, that they have and other things. So we are trying to be much more proactive on that, because clearly the more sites that we can get developed with the planning permission, and the other things that I spoke about a few moments ago, the aim out of all of this work is to maximise residential development in the existing urban areas where it's appropriate, and to avoid, as far as we can possibly do, having to, you know, consider other land applications such as the Greenbelt.
Yes.
from there. So, you know, as I said, we are doing a massive amount of work at the moment on all of these issues to maximise the housing within the urban areas.
It's good to hear that we're doing that, David. Thank you. Stuart?
Two questions. I think, first of all, thanks for the figures. I'm assuming that we'll see them in some detail in the annual monitoring report next month. But I just noted, as you gave the figure 3,648 from the Poverty Register Part 1, that the total actually given in the report is 3,672. So it wasn't clear on the on the discrepancy. However, looking at some of the sites, for example, the site that we've just now given permission to in Morton, the register clearly assumed 38, notwithstanding Chris believed it was 34, now it says it's going to be 20th. That obviously these figures possibly fluid in that sense, but nevertheless, spreadsheets either add up or they don't do. The second point is to pick up the issue of land use that you identified. My members before you talk about the land use designations that you have in the current UDP, etc. I notice there's one of the sites here that is potentially a brownfield site for residential developments. Well, then, please mention. It's listed as well as a potential site that we've accommodated 12 residential properties. And its land use designation, so far as we were concerned, ought to have been residential, given that, exactly what you say, we don't particularly want to be changing land use designations in commercial, industrial and green belt areas to accommodate our residential token. Why then, when we were presented with a commercial use of primarily residential area, did we not consider the land use allocation that it had in primary, or the land use potential for primarily residential in an area washed over by other residential uses. But we are, you know, as officers of government, we are going to have to get a heck of a lot more clever about allocating land for housing in areas where housing is appropriate, like the Malign Police Station, if our ambition is indeed to protect green spaces and the green belt. It's just not satisfactory to have an application front of us for commercial use, which was recommended for approval, where we probably ought to have stuck our heels in and said actually our preferred use of this land, our land designation, ought to have been for residential in that area. So, a third point which just jumped into my head, part one, part two. Part two, the register, these are the deemed planning permission ones, which clearly we will need to give further consideration to. But many of these, listed already have a deemed planning permission one that we've given potentially in a not so distant past. Do they not automatically, if you like, passport through to the to part two, if you like to say, these are ones where actually we're given permission, and it really doesn't matter who the land owner is. Presumably the others, assuming the process will go like this, we will say, here is a site, and we're prepared to accept X number of houses on it, without having to go through the procedure of what, applying for planning permission, or it coming before the planning committee. And how does that also impact on residents and members' rights to remove things from delegation, as would normally be the case now?
Can I just come back on commercial? In terms of that, we have a restriction on it in terms of integrity for 10 years maximum.
I'm still not my name.
But if we were to put residential properties in commercial areas, then that's forever, isn't it?
My site was a non-residential use of the police station. However, when it was a vacant building, almost suddenly it now appears here as a potential site for residential development. And we never took the opportunity. So there's 12 houses, potential houses, that would have got, that's what it would have got. That would potentially have reduced the pressure. Ultimately, that would have fined 12 houses somewhere else. And that's just to equal the total we've got here. Never mind requiring for 5 years, for 5 years supply against whatever the current formula is that the government has asked for the student.
Thank you. Can we just have one meeting, please? In terms of obviously every round of your site application that comes before us that we refuse, and we want to find space somewhere else, that goes without saying. Who's going to come back on those points?
I can answer Stuart's initial the discrepancy with the figures that were reported today are live figures that we have before us now, and we've been reviewing the sites throughout the course of the consultation, because we need to move on this quickly when the consultation's over. We have a statute which you see to get the register publicised. So we're providing the latest figures that we have on our records, and that's we associate that with the sites with planning permission that haven't started. That's likely to sway as well, because we need to consider sites that actually do get implemented after that. Sites that would fall off where the planning permissions lapse, and we can only do that as part of an opening programme when we do our checks on site. There's a couple of ways of doing it. We have the building regulation certificates, and we don't get them for all properties if we use the NHBC route in terms of coming some time further down. As I understand it, I understand that the planning application for the day house was refused.
Yeah.
From a brownfield register point of view, the site is not available for residential if somebody wants to come along and make a proposal. The brownfield register, the purpose behind that, is to identify the sites that are available and ones that the authority can achieve the goal as well. In terms of the part two, in other words, moving in to get planning permission in principle, there are statutory procedures that have to be followed before we get that. Basically, the new regulations of the assessments of sites gone to the council's planning officers to make the assessments. In other words, there's no agent doing technical assessments. So your own planning officers are going to have to consider site implications before recommending that they move into the department. And that's also subject to a statutory open consultation procedure where we put site notices up and we give a set period of time for comments to come in.
I think we could just add to that as well, that members just need to be aware that we can't charge any planning fees for anything that's done through part two as well. So the focus of the work would be on your officers, and we would have to find the costs to do that. But clearly this is in the context of trying to get an acceleration in the housing development. Could I also just say to you as well that whilst we are working at the moment to maximise residential development in the urban areas on allocated sites for housing or on sites that are no longer required for employment uses, you will have seen the recent government consultation, no doubt on housing numbers, and in there are a set of figures for each local authority in the country, and on the basis of our objectively assessed need, we are expected as a local authority to build just over 800 new residential units per annum to meet that need. Now, those figures do not include any aspirations that you may have as a council for growth. Anything that you want to do to put a growth percentage on top of that you need to build more houses. Now, there's a number of figures going around at the moment about what the objective of the assessed need is, which I'm going to tonight, but say it's around the 803 figure. When you then look at the land allocations that we have in Wirral and the land available, we have a shortage of land for residential purposes. And so we are going to have to, as a council, consider that issue as we move forward. You'll have probably seen today the Secretary of State's statement regarding housing and also regarding situations with regards to local plans. And of course we have the Chancellor's statement next week. And I'm expecting that housing will be front and centre probably of some of the announcements that will come out of there. So there's a whole range of issues at the moment just developing on the housing side of things that it is, I think, important for us to understand and to consider. And I know that previously we have discussed about doing a presentation on all of those things to the planning committee, and I think because of the summer recess and various other things, we weren't able to do it. But what I would just wonder, so I had an opportunity to discuss this with the chair first of all, but given the announcements today, given the Chancellor's statement next week, and the way that the housing agenda is moving at the moment, whether, you know, in a few weeks' time, or, you know, sometime just before the next planning committee, we do actually do a briefing for you on all of these things so that you've got the information there, so that when you're making decisions and making considerations of those things, we'll try and put it all in one place for you and into context for the way it was just a suggestion as I was listening to the questions being asked.
No, I think we'd welcome that, that suggestion. We, you know, something that we have as a committee been looking for answers to, and we understand that, you know, there's been all sorts of different stumbling blocks with this, and we've got the green paper and we've got the autumn statement to come, so fingers crossed things will look brighter and better. Okay, Denise, you want to say something?
Yeah, just, you can hear me, can't you? Can you hear me? Well, could I have a copy of figures that group gave us before about housing units and everything else? Is that your first? And then the second thing was, can we not send to all the developers, maybe it's the region, the northwest, or all these, you know, these places that we've got to say, look, come and build on our land. Can we not send that out, or even around the country, or wherever you do, can we not send that to everybody? As you just said that, I can't hear.
Okay, thank you. In terms of the figures I've reported this evening, yes, we will circulate all of those around to you. In December, we published the annual monitoring report, which has a lot of these statistics in it as well. So, you know, that's all public information, which you'll be able to access as well. In terms of the sites in Wirral and the residential development opportunities, both I and many of my colleagues, we meet with all the major house builders that are national names on a regular basis to talk about their plans and proposals for Wirral. We also talk to all the